I want to talk about sex toys. If you want to know the website, it's called wanta.net. W-A-N-T-A. Remember this, Nicola? .net. David, you know that site. So first, I'd like to thank Charlie, the fellow here, the good-looking fellow there. Stop. Bring your face up, Charlie. Charlie runs a company called Brandbeat, which is quite a creative idea. He's helping brands like Shivas create all kinds of entertainment content, music, events, and obviously he goes nuts on social media because he's got good content. So if you're thinking about good content, that's the man to talk to. And because he knows his content, he's here to help make this interview sound good. So hopefully he'll remove all the swear words. I warn you, Rebecca, I swear. But he's from London, so he might leave them in there.
Don't.
For fuck's sake, mate, shut up. Alright, so, first, before Rebecca talks, Rebecca's here to talk about the startup industry. So I got contacted by Jeffrey. Where are you, Jeffrey? Jeffrey. No, he's not Jeffrey. He's some. So this Sunday, there's an event for the entrepreneurial community here. So I thought we'd do a quick advertorial for them. And some here is going to tell you a little bit about the event. So if you've got nothing to do on Sunday and you want to meet up some local startups, come and go to his event. A few words.
Thank you. I'm not Jeffrey, I'm Sam. yeah. So I'm going to introduce an event on this Sunday. It's called eSquare. And it's social entrepreneurship crossover this tech entrepreneurship. So it's on, I think, start at 1 p.m. So if you're interested in this topic, actually this is the first event crossing over the tech and the social. If you are interested, go to e2x.org and then you got all the event details there. We have 10 teams pitching their ideas and also their products. And we got nice speaker from Google, from I think the government and angels. They will share about like what their views and also about their point of opinion. On the event. Okay.
The government's listening.
Sorry.
Do that again. Say see why learn.
Okay.
Sorry. Oh, Occupy Central.
Occupy Central. Okay. So anyone got a question? Okay. Fine.
Fine, thanks.
E2X.org.
E2X.org. Thank you, Sam.
Thank you.
That's the end of the advertising. So Rebecca, can you? And round of applause for Rebecca, who's come all the way from Beijing, New York. Beijing, New York. Where's the... Ta-da.
Who's got the microphone?
Get up on the stage. If you can without elegantly... Oops. No, maybe not. Gonna see. I usually have this.
Okay.
There you go. So, I was very lucky to come across Rebecca because although she's been covering tech startups in the space here, this is actually the first time we've met, which is kind of strange because I've been involved in startups since 97 in Hong Kong. So, Rebecca has two books. One is this one, Startup Asia. And the other one, is that, no, that's Startup Asia. That's Startup Asia in Chinese. Chuang Ye Ya Zhou, available on Dang Dang, right? Where's Silicon Dragon? That's her original book. So I thought, you know, I like to know my speakers before I interview them. So I desperately tried to read her book. And it didn't come in time, so I downloaded it on Kindle. And I actually bought a Kindle so I could read it, if you believe it. Rather than an iPad. But my children pilfered it, so... I've only read a couple of chapters, I apologize. So Rebecca is here because she's got an event tomorrow. Rebecca is very well known, very respected in the tech industry across several continents. Europe, my old continent. America, my future continent. And Asia, my present continent. So I was lucky enough to get her to come in here and talk to us. Usually she's on my side of the table. So she's had a few glasses of wine to be on that side of the table. So she's all relaxed. And I thought we'd start off learning a bit about her, because who knows Rebecca? Who's read some of her books? One of you, two of you. Which ones have you read?
Silicon Dragon.
Silicon Dragon, there you go. Good. If she might sign it for you.
I haven't, just me,
huh?
I have it up here, so.
You don't have it here? Okay. She can sign your t-shirt. Okay. So, Rebecca,
yes.
I understand that you actually originally worked in Hong Kong, is that right?
I've worked in Hong Kong over the years, on and off, since about 1995.
All right, so you've seen it over the... You've seen Hong Kong reinvent itself over the years.
Definitely. And I've seen Beijing and Shanghai grow up.
Yeah, different. So tell us about... I understand that you started off writing... You were in the venture capital kind of field before it became big and juicy in Asia. What were you doing, just so we know a little bit about your background?
Always as a journalist. I was in New York City writing as a journalist, and that's where my career was based. And I got a call from Red Herring magazine during the dot-com boom, and they said, come to Silicon Valley. And they gave me an offer I couldn't refuse, so I went to Silicon Valley. And
did they give you shares or actual real money?
Some shares
they gave you real money too.
Yeah, but the shares never amounted to anything, so unfortunately, unlike some of the other dot-com millionaires, but who really cashed out well. Red Herring never got to that level, but it was great fun being at Red Herring magazine, and there were endless parties, and then of course the bubble burst, and the bubble burst about the late 2001, and. I was in Silicon Valley, and there were a lot of bored venture capitalists there, you know, nothing to do, you know, they were sitting on all these portfolio companies, and they looked out to the frontier, and they saw China.
Can you put the microphone a bit closer?
And they saw China, and basically, what I did as a journalist, using my nose for news, I followed the venture capital money to China. To Beijing and Shanghai, and so I started writing about startups and venture capital in mainland China as it was developing. So I got to have a front row seat as a journalist.
So who was the most interesting person you've interviewed? Was it Jack Ma?
No. Yeah, I like Jack Ma.
Did you interview him when he was in an apartment, or did you interview him when he had a fully fledged company?
Actually, when he had a fully fledged company. But he was very difficult to get an interview even in those days. And I remember getting this interview at the last moment. I was in Shanghai, and they said, oh, Jack, we'll see you, you know, the next day. And that was my last day I was going to be in Shanghai. So, you know, I hightailed it to Hangzhou, saw him, did the interview, took a taxi all the way back to Shanghai Airport, managed to get on the flight that night. And it was a great interview. Jack was really relaxed. We were office in Hangzhou, and I just remember him getting up during the interview and getting his golf club out and started practicing his swing. He was pretty relaxed. I mean, he's a very maverick guy. But
so one of your assumptions in the bit I read about this was that America's not going to be the center of innovation in the future. So you're saying there's a lot happening here in Asia, and you're now, I mean, I understand you're not just looking at China, right? You're looking at India. You're looking at our small city. You're looking at Singapore. You're looking at Vietnam, Indonesia. In all of you, what are you seeing? Where is the trends? Are you seeing distinctive trends in terms of what kind of startups are starting in which countries? And can you give us an example of what's going on?
Sure. I think the center of innovation, of tech innovation, for many, many years was Silicon Valley. And now I think that story has spread. It's spreading rapidly globally, so that there are many, many Silicon Valleys today. And, you know, there's a scene happening here in Hong Kong, there's a scene in Beijing, there's one in Shanghai, there's one in London, there's one in Israel, there's one in New York. And this startup story has gone global. And it was always really centered around Boston, the 128, the Route 128 cluster around Boston, and then around Silicon Valley and Seattle. And, you know, a lot of places want to be the next Silicon Valley because a tremendous wealth has been created there, tremendous
so
companies.
People like David and myself, who we were talking earlier, who've been in this industry a bit longer than other people, remembered that in the early days it was C2C,
yes.
Which is, do any of you know what that stands for? copy to China.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
There was that kind of mad cloning
sure.
going on.
Yeah.
Are you seeing that now that it's really is invention? Is it innovation? I mean, when you go around, are you seeing
yeah.
people, is India, China, Singapore,
yeah.
Hong Kong, are we ahead of what's happening in America?
Well, in some areas, in the mobile internet space, I think because the mobile communications market is very
that's
advanced.
Convenient. That's the industry I'm in. What
oh,
a coincidence.
So there you go. But I think, yeah, sure, the story was originally copy to China. And every successful business model that it worked in.
So in your Silicon Dragon book, which was written
yeah.
in 2008,
yes.
which I presume meant you researched in
2007,
six. So in those times it was copy to China. It wasn't really
yeah.
ideas originating out of China.
Well, the theme of that book was really, the first half of the book was the copy to China model. So there's a chapter on the Facebook of China, there's a chapter on the eBay of China.
At the time, what was I'd be interested, what was officially the Facebook of China?
Back then it was Renren.
It was Renren.
Yeah.
Not Caixin or whatever.
Yeah, well Caixin, yeah, definitely that was part of it.
Okay.
And in fact, I talk about the rivalry between those two companies and what happened there and the lawsuit.
Yeah, I read
that
chapter, Dirty Tricks.
Yeah, Dirty Tricks.
So is the internet in China all about dirty tricks?
There's a lot of dirty tricks.
Quite aggressive.
Yeah, there's a lot of copying among the Chinese companies. And, you know, it's one good idea happens and another good idea happens.
So back in 2006, though, it was copying. What are you seeing now? This was came out 2011, right? So what are you seeing that's different?
I think you're seeing more innovation happening in China, and I think if you look at WeChat, you could say that that's pretty innovative.
I learned something very interesting today about WeChat, is that actually Tencent looked at Google, and they saw how Google had a one day off a week, and they said, that's not going to work in China. So what they decided to do was they actually got two teams to compete against each other
mm-hmm.
to produce the same product. Because they wanted the internal battle. So that created entrepreneurship within a big company, which
yeah.
I thought was very interesting
that
as a
is.
Way to innovate.
Yeah, this is hard. Once you're a big company, how do you continue that innovative culture? You know, you can acquire other startups, which Tencent has done too. Or you could try to instill it, internally. But it's very difficult, and many companies have failed on that.
So you've been traveling to China, India. Tell us a little bit about India and what you're seeing happening in India in the internet space.
Yeah, I think India is about 5 years, at least 5 years behind China. India doesn't have all the success stories that China had in the internet space, all the IPOs, all the successful companies like, Dang Dang, Renren, Yoku, Tudou, etc., Baidu. India doesn't really have a stream of those.
Was there a C2I? Was there a period of copy to India,
yeah.
with all the returnee engineers going back to India and saying, I'm going to set something up here.
Yeah, and one of the reasons I wrote my second book, Startup Asia, is because I saw what was happening in China happening in other markets in Asia. So it was very interesting that some of the same investors that had invested in these models in China then were invested in India. And they took the same ideas. So the India.
Oh, so they took the copy to China to India.
Yeah.
In a daisy chain. Is that what the copy to China, to India,
to Vietnam,
to Singapore?
Yeah. So you see some of the same models and some of the same venture capital firms behind
them. So is it driven by the venture capital or is it driven by the entrepreneurs?
It has to be. It's both. You have to have both.
But you said the same. Like your book, there's one character I know, William Bao Bin, right?
Sure.
He originally started in Beijing. He then went to Singapore, then he was in Vietnam, then he was in India, he was kind of all over the place. So
that's true.
Is it those kind of guys that make it happen?
Yeah, I think so. You need somebody who's a mover and shaker who, transports these ideas.
So China was, it was Jack Ma, it was put online, it was kind of Alibaba and Renren when you first talked to them, right?
Yeah.
So what did you see in India how is it different? How has the internet evolved there that's different from China?
Well, it's more mobile internet.
In India?
Yeah.
But they don't have smartphones, right? I thought it was a very small proportion of the audience, of the community.
Yeah, there's one startup I'm thinking of from India called InMobi, and they're...
Yeah, there's actually a guy from InMobi in here.
Really?
Where are you? Where's he gone? InMobi.
Oh, really?
There.
Oh. wow.
He's actually Portuguese, but in this light he could pass for it.
Yeah, you know, it's now number one mobile advertising network. It's number two?
It's number two. He's not a very good salesman, don't listen to him. Our ad network's much better.
The CEO told me it's the first. Anyhow, I think
so. That, how did that start in India? Was it they saw something in the States, copy it, or was it just like, how did that take off?
Yeah, I mean, the founder had Silicon Valley experience, had Silicon Valley venture investors, and he tried a couple of business models first, and they didn't work. And then
what were they? They were all.
They were in the advertising space, but I don't remember exactly right now. But they were. He hit upon this mobile. The idea was to go to the mobile space. So the other ones were more internet related, not the mobile element. So once they got that, then it really took off. And then they had all these engineering talent in Bangalore that they could feed into. And, you know, India's got great engineering talent. So you never have a shortage of talent who could build these new startups in India. And the story, one of the interesting differences between the China startups and the India startups is the India startups tend to go global much faster. Yeah.
The Indian startups, is that a language thing?
It's partly language, and it's partly because the Indian.
Are they more impatient than the Chinese? Than a bloody hell, I want to get out. Is it?
I think the Chinese are more impatient, but
is it the route? Is it the path to IPO? Is that the reason? What is the driver?
That's where the market is, and in India there are some markets that are just not developed enough for their products, so they'll go outside. And because of the English language compatibility, they can. And in China, you still have this huge market opportunity within China. So this is one of the reasons that you see so many of these Chinese companies staying at home.
And because what you're saying is the Indians are 5 years behind, but they've accelerated the international element.
They have.
Whereas the Chinese were ahead, but they've only just, apart from Alibaba,
only
recently started to go international, right?
That's
WeChat
true.
And all that.
Yeah. That's true.
But they seem to be doing quite cleverly. I mean, they're buying companies in other countries, they're localizing the content, they're hiring local people. The only impediment is censorship. Mm-hmm. And I don't think Indians have much censorship, unless it's religious hate, right? The rest of it's kind of do what you want to. Are you seeing that? Is that going to get in the way of Chinese companies going multinational?
I don't think it'll get in the way of them going multinational. When I talk to the startups and the entrepreneurs in China, they don't really talk about the censorship issue. But it is an issue that I hear a lot outside of China. When people look into the market in China, that's a big concern. We will not go into that market as a multinational because of this issue. Google obviously withdrew, Facebook's not in, and these issues. So I think it's an issue for those going in, but for those who are in the market and are local, they've just accepted it as a cost of doing, or a way of
I saw
doing
that,
business.
I actually saw that your the prologue, Kai-Fu Lee, right?
Yeah.
He's actually got a blog. Every time he gets a blog, he posts about how long it takes for the censors to catch up with him, right?
Yeah.
So I don't know if you guys have read this, but he usually has a window of, what is it, 2 minutes before they start to shut down
It's pretty fast.
Yeah.
So
let's go back to India. So in India, you were saying originally you were seeing mobile stuff. What else is kind of different about India in terms of the startup culture and what people are doing?
There's a more philosophical bent to everything. Yeah.
Which means?
It means if you ask a question, you're not going to get a direct answer.
Even on the internet? Shall I buy it or not?
Well,
maybe.
It was still click, right? You might hover on the maybe a little bit longer.
Oh, I see. But so, I mean, I see, obviously India is a very large country. The supply chain is very confusing.
Yeah.
It's very hard to buy things.
Sure.
Are you seeing, I understand that e-commerce is really taking off in India. Is this something
is.
That
yeah.
is you see as the, is really the potential in that
I
country?
I think so. Yeah, there's a number of startups in the whole e-commerce area. There's Myntra, there's Iogi, there's many, many e-commerce startups. And it's a field that's probably too crowded right now. And so you'll probably...
So the one that did an IPO was something about buses, right? Where you could
well,
kind of book your
trip.
Bus or how does that work?
Yeah, Make My Trip. It's actually, it was sort of, you had C-Trip in China, and they made my trip from India. And they both, you know, went public.
Were they funded by the same people?
Make My Trip, no, actually in this case not.
And Make My Trip was booking hotel rooms, or I thought there was another service that was about, you could basically book your bus trip through, you know, to go and see your relatives in...
But I think you're thinking of another one,
okay.
A red bus.
Okay.
Yeah.
So Make My Trip was exactly like C-Trip, it's basically a travel.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've had that here, we had Priceline.
Sure.
Came here.
Yeah.
We have Zuji. So what about in you know what you're saying in Southeast Asia? You've been in Vietnam. I was there for my Easter holidays.
Okay.
And there's a lot of money around that place. And it's very scrappy.
Yeah, I like the scrappy quality of it.
So
because it reminds me of what China was like, you know, when I was there first covering the Chinese market.
And it's got an element of communism and censorship that kind of adds to the spice.
Yeah.
So tell us what's going on. What are you seeing in places like Vietnam? Where is the action?
Well, again, there are a lot of e-commerce and social commerce startups and gaming. Gaming is a big area. There's a company called Vinagame in Ho Chi Minh City, and Tencent is invested in them. So
Tencent is invested in a gaming company?
In Vietnam.
That's interesting. So it's Tencent being a VC. It's not a VC being a VC. It's Tencent doing it itself.
Well, Tencent actually took a stake in this company.
Because I understood that Tencent also recently bought a company in Thailand, right? Expanding.
Yeah.
The Chinese buying into other companies.
Yeah, no, I think it's a good model for them. And they have IDG, IDG Ventures was one of the original backers. And so they were a backer of Tencent and a backer of this Vietnamese company. So they put them together. Then they brought in a business guy from Tencent and put them into the Vietnam company and then helped them grow. And you know, expand and bring the ideas from China.
So what you're saying is that the internet conglomerates in China are becoming like little Silicon Valleys. They're the ones who are going and they're the ones providing the venture capital. Is that because
in some cases,
I think the problem I've seen in most of Southeast Asia is that venture capital doesn't really exist.
That's true.
You know, it's family money.
Yeah,
it's
true.
See, you know, family and friends.
That's true.
And the big guys only come in when you're, you know, ready to do an IPO. They don't care about this. Is that what you see?
No, I agree. I agree. Yeah. Singapore is different. Singapore has an angel investment community behind it.
Is that a real angel investment community? Or is that like fabricated by Temasek? I always like teasing Singapore. So is.
Yeah.
I want to know the difference between Hong Kong and Singapore. You're an outsider. Who's better? What's that? What are you saying? I've got some rotten tomatoes in the back there. Who's got the rotten tomatoes? Crystal? Is Crystal here? Crystal's from Singapore.
Okay.
She came all the way from Singapore because she was so bored. You're the internet there. She tweeted about everything in Singapore. She was very well connected. You know, like, Crystal, say hello. She's the social maven of Singapore. Talk to her. Very connected into the space there. But tell us about what you're seeing. Why is Singapore such a terrible place to do a startup?
Well,
do you like another glass of wine?
No, I do have a whole chapter on Singapore in my new book, Startup Asia. But I did, you know, in Singapore, the story is the government is really trying to induce entrepreneurship. But it's not something that you can make happen. It has to happen from a grassroots level, as you know, here in Hong Kong. So I think the Singaporean government is not going to stop trying. And I think, you know, you have this whole, the universities there, like National University of Singapore, is really pushing the idea of entrepreneurship, and they're incubating a number of startups. And then they have this program called Global Entropolis every year, and they, you know, have a whole series of tech and startup events. But the issue is that the Singaporean culture doesn't really lend itself to entrepreneurship. So a lot of, you know, young graduates want to go and take the safe route, go to an investment bank, go to an insurance company, and it's easy enough to do that in Singapore. So, you know, there's not the incentive. And it's a little bit too far removed from mainland China, you know, the big frontier market that Hong Kong, you know, from Hong Kong you can leverage and get into.
Do you agree, Crystal? She's silent. She's not going to say anything. So, I remember Singapore is interesting because Singapore is very good at importing talent.
Yeah. Yeah.
And a bit like America, right? A lot of the talent came from other countries.
True. From India, so, for instance.
Yeah, so yeah. They decide, right, we want to build a pharmaceutical industry or pharmacology or...
Yeah.
And they say, right, we're going to hire all the people from Israel who develop bombs to attack Iranians. They're going to develop our pharmaceutical industry.
Yeah.
Right, we're going to hire all of the people who know about startups. They even, you know, persuaded... what's his name? One of the Facebook investors. What's his name?
Oh, yeah. Co-founder.
Huh? Spanish guy.
He left for tax
Dave,
reasons.
Dave, what was his name?
Eduardo
Savarin.
Yes.
Savage. Savage.
Yeah.
Savarin. I tried to contact him. He was off the radar. But so he went to Singapore. So obviously they did something good there.
And a lot of wealthy people have gone to Singapore. And so
but does
this
that
is
mean there's
one
a
of the reasons.
Does that mean that the money's there for the startups?
Yeah, right? there's an angel investment community in Singapore.
Because the problem we have here is there's lots of ideas, and I actually think Hong Kong is a hotbed of ideas,
mm-hmm.
but there's no money.
Well,
and the money is kind of borrowed from the government on some weird terms where you have to kind of give it back to them after a year, possibly.
Well, you know, it's interesting because when I first started covering venture capital, well, there were a lot of venture capital funds based here in Hong Kong, and now a lot of them moved to Beijing or Shanghai, but now what I'm seeing is this Hong Kong startup culture is happening here. And so
how many startups in this room? Oh, there you go.
See, I'm encouraged by it. Yeah.
How many of you got government money from the Hong Kong government?
Hell no.
Hell no. Hell no. Oh, there you go. He's a smart guy. How much money did you get?
$100,000
Hong Kong dollars. That's going to get you really far. Right. So.
See that? I mean, one of the issues with getting government funding is there's strings attached. I mean, you got to have these milestones, and you got to make the milestones. Of course, you do.
Now, the only strings in Hong Kong is that you've got to put your office in excuse the French, but fuck nowhere.
Yeah.
In other words, Cyberport.
Yeah.
Or Science Park, right?
Yeah.
The advantage of Science Park is you can get engineers bussed in from Shenzhen, which does happen.
Yeah.
The advantage of Cyberport is that the air is better. Right?
Yeah.
And
well, I'm staying out by Cyberport for a reason.
And there's a very nice incubator program
yes,
there, right?
Yes,
but
yes.
It's always hard. I worked at Cyberport. The problem was when you hire people, they go, 7 o'clock, I'm off. So you get no overtime.
Right.
And I actually had people turn up. By the time they got there for the interview, they turned up and said, I'm sorry, this is too far. I'm not going to apply for this job.
Mm-hmm.
So there was an issue.
Yeah.
So, I mean, here, what are you seeing in terms of, you said the venture capitalists are here, but they're...
I'm starting to see new angel investor interest and new venture capital interest in Hong Kong.
In Hong Kong.
Yeah. And so when I said this, I met with some Beijing venture capitalists last week, and they said, oh, really? Good luck. But then when I talked to the Hong Kong VCs, they say, well, the Beijing and Shanghai don't really realize what's happening here. And I think there is some truth to that. I think Hong Kong does need, you know, a really good success story, successful entrepreneurs who can go out and spread the word. So.
There are actually, I can give you two examples of one. One is a company called Six Waves.
Okay, sure.
Which, you know about?
Yeah.
You know, they started off as ex-Yahoo guys. They saw that games on Facebook were in English. They started doing them in Chinese, in Russian, in Spanish, in Greek. And they got $17 million in funding. Another one is, this is getting my mind. No, I'll think about it in a moment. Is a coach, they had them here actually, a guy who's developed an app for coaches on an iPad.
Okay.
He's just started to be promoted as the kind of poster boy of Hong Kong.
Okay.
So.
Well, that's good. Because, you know, I remember, you know, during the dot-com boom, there was a lot of action here in Hong Kong. A lot of internet startups.
Yeah, I was one of the recipients. I had a startup trading internet bandwidth.
Okay.
We got money from J.H. Whitney. We got $2 million
okay.
US. Wasn't
right.
That.
That's good.
But all the VCs, just what happened was in Hong Kong, the government said, I don't know how to invest. So they gave it to VC firms who said, we don't know either, but we'll take the commission. And a few invested. So where do you, I mean, you know, you. So you've seen Hong Kong, I mean, what are you seeing? So Singapore, you're saying it's not really, the culture's not there. Right?
Yeah.
But the
government's
supporting.
You know, it's interesting because when I've spoken in Singapore, you know, usually...
You're pretty close.
When I've spoken at some events in Singapore, you know, usually you ask for Q&A afterwards, not a single person says anything. You know, I just wonder, are you there?
That's surprising, because what I've learned about Singapore is that you get a lot of, it's quite easy to get funded as a startup.
Yeah.
You can get approximately 250,000 US.
Yeah, from the government.
From the government.
Mm-hmm.
But what happens is that all these startups are there, and they get to a point that they need to go bigger.
Right.
And then there's blockage. There's nobody to support you to the next step.
Yeah,
right?
Or
you're not mature enough to go to the next step.
Yeah, and the complaint is that those who do invest in these Singaporean startups, that they do not do it on